We're going to start the talk now, which will be on Postfix by Wietse Venema.
Very good.
Take it away.
Thank you. And I haven't started yet. So what's new about SMTP, people ask me. Well, SMTP hasn't really changed in the last 20 plus years or so. But of course, everybody knows that the internet has changed in the last 20 years or so, and it keeps changing. And so what motivates me to keep talking about POSIX so late in its life cycle is that things are still changing. And this presentation is relatively unique in that most of the material will be new. So you're guinea pigs. Okay, so this is an overview of my presentation. I will give a little bit about the original backgrounds from 15 years ago, but I keep it really short, promise. I show a little bit about spam around the clock, which motivates the way that POSIX has evolved in the last 4 years, and then I will present some new stuff. So over the life cycle of POSIX, which spans from beta release in 1998 to the present, I will be talking mostly about the last 4 years in the life cycle. First, why would anybody in their right mind write another mail server? As if there are not enough mail servers already. And I have done my duty as system administrator myself. And so I know that if you have a mail server, you need to learn to configure it, you have to keep it alive, keep it happy. Then you have your setmail, you have postfix, you have qmail, you have xm, you have every one of them has its own idiosyncrasies. You need to learn how to keep them alive, keep them happy, and deal with their idiosyncrasies. So the reason for me to write POSIX early on was that SendMail had a history of serious security vulnerabilities. SendMail has improved, but in late 96, when I started to think about maybe we do need another mail server, It had a very bad episode with many cert advisories. So, and the architecture that I chose initially was mainly for security reasons. And as it turns out to be, it was a good choice for many other reasons too. But initially chosen for architecture reasons, it is compartmentalized in many small little programs, kind of like a Titanic. And as we all know, the Titanic did sink. But it's not supposed to sink so easily. If you take care of the system properly, it won't sink so easily. It will actually resist a lot of abuse. So overall, it is partitioned like an internet router. It has input interfaces on the left, and they will take email in whatever representation is native to that particular channel. If it's a Unix mailbox mail submission, then it looks different from SMTP. SMTP has all kinds of cruft around it. So on the left side, the input interfaces strip off all those media-specific information. They store it in the queue. They chew on it. They decide how to deliver it. And on the right-hand side are the programs that deliver mail. If it's delivery via SMTP, it puts on all the SMTP cruft again and sends it out. There's local delivery. And there is delivery to non-postfix systems. Those programs are privileged, unavoidably, because there is a change in privilege from postfix to something else. And changing privilege is a privileged operation, so that's why they are colored red. But none of those programs is exposed directly to the network, and that's a crucial point in the postfix architecture. So that's all I'm going to say about what happened 15 years ago. I'm now going to speed forward into the near present. As I was preparing my talk, I made speaker notes and just to make sure that I don't miss important information, including where I am on the time schedule. Okay, this is a representation of spam as seen at an academic hospital in Berlin, Germany. One of the early POSIX adopters is using my mail system. He always takes the latest version, and so I can use him as an early adopter, and he does experiments and measurements for me. So this is one of the measurements. This is the most recent one. It ends in the middle of January, and it shows the total amount of spam at all hours of the day from anywhere on the planet. And it's spam according to spamhouse.org. If Spamhouse says this is a bad client, then it's counted here. And as you see, spam arrives at all hours of the day. So by itself, the picture is not very useful because, well, if it arrives all hours a day, there's no particular decision that you can make based on this. If you look at specific origins, then you see that spam is not a round-the-clock operation. It's actually very focused on a particular time of the day. And it's, of course, what you see here, this is spam from India, and the hours that India is sending spam is basically daytime in India. So people wake up, they turn on their PC, PC starts sending spam, end of the day, they go to bed, they turn off the PC, and the PCs stop sending spam. So this is a very specific pattern to PCs that are infected with malware. They start sending spam in the morning, and they end spamming in the evening. Many countries have similar patterns. India is on the right, so they're all shown on the same scale. And just to make the picture a little bit more informative, I blew it up so that India is a little bit off the scale. In the middle is Iran, and Iran is actually relatively new in the world of spam. I collected the data, I analyzed it, and I thought, I haven't seen Iran listed up as the second biggest spammer in a while. And what happened is that in July 2013, laptop computers became available in Iran. And guess what? They become infected. And that's exactly what happened. So daytime in India is a few hours different from daytime in Iran. And on the left-hand side is Peru, which is definitely in a different continent. And again, daytime. So basically, the picture that I showed in the beginning, where spam is almost uniform around the clock, it's actually spam from different parts of the world in different time zones that adds up to the total pattern. And from the total pattern, the only conclusion that you can make is that in the Pacific Ocean, there are not a lot of spammers. On the other hand, some countries have a more, they don't have this typical spam bot infected PC pattern. Like China is really round the clock. So they must have, besides bot infected PCs, also some persistent infrastructure like data centers where people rent equipment and send spam without being bothered by authorities. USA is also similar to China in that respect, although it still has a night and day pattern, but it's not as pronounced as the, what is it, developing countries, the developing economies. Spain, again, is more like Russia and its neighbors. So with this motivation, go to the recent developments in Postfix. This one started 4 years ago. And the picture shows spam over time according to what's called now Symantec. It was a company that was acquired by Symantec, and of course, I forget the name, mail channels, mail something. They were doing these reports, and they were taken over by Symantec, and so now it's all Symantec names. But on the left hand of the chart, there's a little bit of 2000, there's 2009, and before 2009 comes 2008. The spam levels were slowly increasing over 2008 and 9, and in 2010 they reached a maximum. After 2010, Microsoft and several other companies worked together to take down a couple of major botnets, and that has had a serious impact on spam volume. So in 2010, 90%+ of email was spam, and 95% of the spam was sent from botnets. So I just simplify it to 90-90. 90% is spam on average in that year, and some 90% of spam comes from botnets. So what does that mean for a mail server like Postfix? I should say a few words about optimization. So I built Postfix as a high-performance mail server that receives mail, delivers it correctly, and does it all without using a lot of system resources. So I have this highly optimized, high-performance mail receiving, mail delivering system. And at this point, most of the mail that is offered to my mail server on the internet is never going to be received. So that's an optimization that I made for mail that I am going to receive, as opposed to most of the mail I'm not going to ship. Most of my mail server is now doing most of its time not receiving mail. So that's one optimization that doesn't work very well. This is typical for Unix MTAs, Postfix, SendMail, QMail, XSIM, all of them, what they are built as one process per connection. One process per connection. And so if you have hundreds or thousands of connections coming at your mail server, and most of them are not going to deliver mail, you're spending a lot of expensive processes doing this. And I was getting concerned about the scalability of Postfix in 2009, 2010, and decided that I have to get rid of all these useless connections. And so I put something in front of Postfix that is called PostScreen that throws away most of the client connections that it gets and only gives the client connections that are likely to be good to a real SMTP server process. So that's the general purpose of this thing. Many things in Postfix are not inventions from me. Lots of things have already been done before, and there's a whole list of people, organizations that have done similar things in the past. There's OpenBSD SpamD, which was basically a front-end daemon that takes all the connections and decides who gets to go talk to the mail server. There is mail channels traffic control, a different approach that also throttles down incoming mail. There is Michael Tokarev, an early Postfix adopter, who did basically this when his server was just flooded by spammers and all server processes were busy, no mail was going through, and he put something in front of it that just accepted all connections and somehow kept thousands of botnet connections busy doing nothing, while in the meantime he could still receive mail. But I just tried to do a good job and making it easy to use with Postfix. So given that PostScreen is just a first stage in front of Postfix itself, it doesn't have to stop all spam. It just has to get rid of most of the zombie and botnets. And so it is the first layer in a multi-layer defense. And the idea is you use the cheapest defense first, hopefully eliminate most of the garbage. Then you use progressively more expensive mechanisms to eliminate what is left over. So you use a cheap filter at the front, and you use your really expensive filter with Spam Assassin way at the end, only after you've eliminated all the other things with cheaper mechanisms. Okay, we're good. Before I do some nuts and bolts, the overall architecture of PostScreen is relatively simple. There is a fast path, that's the green boxes on the left. The idea is that that you want to minimize the pain for senders that are good. And so what you do is, once you decide that the sender is good, you store that information in a temporary whitelist. And so the first thing that POSIX does when it receives a connection is, do I know this client already? Is he good? In that case, I'm not going to bother with anything else. I just hand it off to a real SMTPD process. And so this is a quick read-only lookup in a table, and it needs to be really fast because it determines how many of these connections per second I can handle. If the client is not in the whitelist, or the client is in the whitelist but it has expired, it goes to a slower path, and there are several tests to find out if this client is bad. One test involves DNS lookups. With DNS, you can query other people's reputation lists, and you can see if this is a bad client, or maybe if it's a good client. There are whitelists that say, we list only male IP addresses that are good. Don't bother blacklisting them. You would lose mail that you would want to have. So the slow path does a number of tests, and I will illustrate a few later on. And if the tests are passed, the client is put in a whitelist and gets to talk to a real SMTP server process. So that's the slow path. It can take up to 6 seconds. On the right-hand side is the reject path. The red one is for clients that fail tests, and they aren't just dropped, because that would be bad. If you see a client is bad, you drop the connection, you never know what mail you didn't receive. You still want to have information about what was this client going to send me. And so there's a dummy SMTP server engine that does not receive mail. It just talks SMTP, and it gets the halo, the mail from, the recipient to, and with every recipient to, it says sorry. And if the client says data, it says no can do. And so eventually the client will disconnect, or if it doesn't, it is kicked off due to a timeout. But this is all is done in one process, so I'm not wasting an SMTP server process per connection. This thing also includes a dummy TLS engine, event-driven and all, simplified version of what Timo is using in his Dovecot server. Was interesting, by integrating this into POSIX, I found some bugs in TLS implementations that existed not only in POSIX, but also in Gmail and in a whole bunch of other, like 50% of the internet SMTP TLS implementations were having this new vulnerability that I found. So that was CVE, the last CVE for POSIX. Later, I will talk about TLS in POSIX and show that whatever was going on didn't really matter. So this is the overview of PostScreen. Now, a few nuts and bolts examples. It can query DNS, whitelist, and blocklist servers. It makes the queries in parallel, so you don't have to wait for one after the other. Client connects, it makes all the lookups that are configured, and when the replies come in, which is usually very quickly, it can make a ruling. If the client is bad, then it will not be allowed to send mail. It will end up in the dummy SMTP engine, which looks very much like POSIX. That's actually very funny. You see all these clients coming up talking to POSIX, they think, but they never even get past the initial port. There are filters on DNS replies. That's a very old POSIX feature, but I just mentioned it here. And recently, I think this is a POSIX 2.11 feature, and POSIX 2.11 came out a few weeks ago, so this is really new. A feature that allows clients to skip all other tests. So I have this list of half dozen tests. If the client is listed, I give the result a weight of -2 instead of +2 for spam house. And I have a threshold of -2. If the result of the score is -2 or lower, then the client gets a free pass. It doesn't have to do all the other tests. So that's a quick way to deal with things like Google that come from different IP addresses all the time. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but if you get mail from Gmail, it will come from this IP address. And if for some reason your postfix says 4XX, please try again later, it will come from another IP address the next time. So that means that byte listing based on IP address dynamically in postfix doesn't really work very well. You have to rely on byte lists externally that say Gmail is good and just let them go. Nothing forbids me from having a little bit of fun with spam bots. The picture on top is a little dog. There's a saying that says, how do you know if a house has a dog? Imagine you're a dog tax collector or something like that. You need to find out if people have a dog that isn't registered properly. How do you know if a house has a dog? Well, you could just wait until you hear the dog, but that could take a long time. The quick way is you ring the doorbell and it will bark immediately. And Postfix does a similar thing with spam bots. How do you find out if spam bots, if a spam bot is a spam bot? Well, spam bots have a very short life cycle. They can spam for only 2 hours or so and then they're blacklisted. They eventually run into a spam trap and they go onto the blacklist and everybody knows this guy is bad. Don't take their mail. So in a very short time, they have to do all their deliveries, and therefore they accelerate their deliveries. They cut corners in the implementation. They don't wait. They talk before their turn, and they fall into traps like this. So a good SMTP client will, when it gets a two-line server greeting, 220 minus, blah blah blah, 220 space, blah blah blah. And it only starts talking after the 220 space. That's what the SMTP protocol definition says. A server response ends in number, number, number space. If it's number, number, number dash, then there is more to come. And so this is a very easy way to distinguish good from bad client implementations. What POSIX does is it sends the 220 minus blah, 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 and it waits for a little while. And darn it, especially a few years ago, all the spam bots would immediately start talking. So this was a very quick way to find out if something is a spam bot. And I say there, wait for a few seconds. As the picture shows, you don't really have to wait for a few seconds. So depending on the country where the spammer is, and Einstein's speed of light of 300,000 kilometers per second or something like that, they will start talking within 0.1, 0.2, 0.3 seconds with their Halo command. So this was 4 years ago. Russia was one of the biggest spammers, and they show up very big in here. So this was the fun that I had with making clients talk before their turn. So nowadays, it's no longer like most of the spam bots that fall into this trap. Spammers improve over time, just like everything else. They adopt RFCs. They are sometimes early adopters of RFCs. They know what they need to do to get their mail through. Okay. A quick update on things that's new in Postfix 2.11. I'm doing this slide in the middle of the talk instead of at the end because I don't want to fizzle out my talk with tiny little crafty stuff. Among the more noteworthy things is documentation. We added a web page on perfect forward secrecy for reasons that everybody should know. That perfect forward secrecy has gotten a lot more interest recently. And Postfix has always supported forward secrecy from the day that TLS support was added, except that nobody knew it, and it was really hard to find out because Postfix has a TLS configuration guide, which is about this long, and the information is all distributed all over the file, so you would have to read the whole file to find out if and how forward secrecy is done in Postfix. There's a new document that describes it very short. It says what it is, how it works in Postfix. You can skip over the text that this explains how it works and just go to the text that says, this is what you need to do. And then it's followed by examples of, this is what it looks like when it works. So makes it easy. TLS support for the MySQL database connections, always good. I eliminated a long-standing annoyance from PostFix. You could not have user plus domain, user plus extension and user minus extension at the same time. That was always a frustration for people who have, you know, systems that do one or the other or both. You can do it now in PostFix at the same time. It will work. PostFix will just pick the first one, the first separator that it sees, and then it will split the others there. And the fourth bullet, I added some code to make PostFix easy to manage. PostFix has two configuration files. One is main.cf, that's name equals value. That's a brain that simple format. You can even maintain it without a text editor, but PostFix has a command that does it for you. And then there is master.cf, which is a totally different format. It's more like inad.conf. And maintaining it, even with the text editor, is tricky, easy to mess up. So what I've done is I've written my own parser that will represent the contents of master.cf as name equals value. And you can read, list, or change settings. For example, you can set all the change root columns to n with the first command. It sets this field to n for all master.cf entries. And here is how you add a parameter to a master.cf setting, or you change it. Postcons.p, name of service, name of transport, and then the parameter equals the value. It's just simple as that. I did this not because I had time to waste, but it because PostFix needs to be easier to manage with other programs. And so if you have a uniform name equals value for all the important parts of PostFix configurations, you can query the system, you can change it, and it actually becomes possible to manage it with a different program. So those programs don't have to parse PostFix configuration files. There's a benefit there too. This was remotely inspired by Red Hat's Augias system, if you're familiar with that. Ah, the really new stuff. And 5 minutes behind schedule. So, PKI. First, I will explain in 3 slides why PKI, global PKI, does not work with SMTP. But the first slide explains why PKI, global PKI, doesn't work in general. I did some work early in 2013, which involved playing man in the middle, feeding false certificates to clients, and they would just happily do things. And I realized that email, of course, has the same problems. Although the implementation that follows is by Victor, one of the co-developers. So this is how, in theory, PKI works. You have you connect to a server. The server gives you a certificate and maybe some other intermediate certificates. And then the client starts verifying. You look at the root certificate and say, do I know the root certificate? If I don't know the root certificate, then I cannot really vouch for anything. But if the client knows the root certificate, then it can verify the other certificates. And so once those are verified as authentic, then it makes a comparison of the name of the server with the name in the certificate. And now it knows I'm talking to the right server. I do not have to trust DNS. DNS could have sent me somewhere else and I would have found out. I do not have to trust IP. If IP had sent me somewhere else, it would not have the right server certificate. So that's how it works in theory. But in practice, there are hundreds of CA certificate authority organizations worldwide. Some significant portion of them are owned or under control by governments. These hundreds of certificate authorities have a thousand or so registration authorities, those are the people who do the actual paperwork. They create this, create a certificate request. So you go to one of those RAs, you fill in the paperwork, they do it, and then you get your certificate. So if any of those makes a mistake, intentionally or unintentionally, they can give a certificate in anyone's name, including your name. So this is not really good from a security point of view. There are too many trusted parties. With SMTP, there is an additional problem. There is an RFC that says how you do TLS for SMTP. It defines the start TLS command. But it doesn't say how you verify the server certificate. Result, nobody verifies server certificates. And the reason is that what name should you verify? Should it be the domain and the email address? Well, that's a problem because one SMTP server can receive mail from many domains. What certificate should it give you? The RFC predates SNI. So there was no way for clients to say, please give me this certificate for this server. You can't do it with the mail server hostname because the mail server hostname is what you got from DNS. And if you trust DNS to give you the name for a certificate, then you don't really do anything about security. So this makes SMTP TLS security difficult, and this makes it even more difficult. The problem is that the client doesn't even know that it should be using TLS. How does the client know? There is no SMTPS:// in the email address. You just get an email address, you deliver it, you make a connection, you say hello to the server, and the server says, I can talk TLS. You say, okay, well, I can talk TLS too, so let's do TLS. And then on the left-hand side, you get this TLS tunnel for sending email. But on the right-hand side, the same thing could equally well happen. You connect to the server, but there is a man in the middle, and the man in the middle removes the I can speak TLS from the server's response. And at that point, you have no choice, you just deliver mail in plain text. So this is called a downgrade attack, and it works because the client doesn't know that it should, that the server can speak TLS. It's very easy for an attacker to force the client to send plain text. So, drum roll. There is a new protocol. It's called DANE, DNS-based authentication of named entities. And in summary, what's happening is when you want to connect to a server, you look up the server certificate or certificate fingerprint or public key fingerprint in DNS. And once you get it from DNS, you connect to the server, you compare it against the server certificate and say, yes, this is the certificate that I was expecting based on what DNS told me. And so it's TLSA records in DNS that contain the expected server or intermediate certificate or public key or a hash thereof. Of course, this requires that you use secure DNS. And if there is a bitch on the internet, then it is secure DNS. So it remains to be seen how this catches on. You're replacing trust in PKI with trust in secure DNS. But it can really work. So if it works, this is how it is preferably used with SMTP. There are four scenarios. As any good security protocol, it's over-engineered, so it has four profiles. Hopefully not all of them will ever be used, but you know, that's what security does. But of the two that are of most interest for SMTP, you get a hash of a public key or a certificate from DNS, and you apply it to either the issuer certificate, that's the mini PKI scenario, or this is the no PKI scenario, you get the server certificate hash or public key hash, and you compare it directly against the server certificate. You don't rely on this chain of certificates that historically was used to authenticate a certificate. There are also transitional modes, two of them, where you actually do both these things. You have both the certificate chain from the roots down, and you have a TLSA record that says, well, this or that certificate must match this fingerprint. So you can have a sort of transitional where historical clients that use the chain verification still work, and where clients that take advantage of secure DNS work in this way, and they don't have to rely on a secure root CA. Which secure root CA? So, nuts and bolts example. This is Debian. The TLSA was announced in 2012, so there are not a large number of servers that implement the protocol at this time, but Debian.org and NIST.gov are among them. Debian has, let me just go down. First, you look up the mail server names for Debian.org. That's the first blue box, and there are two of them. One is called Melee, and the other one is called Moffat. So the next step is I go look at the A records for Melee. And Melee has 82.195.75.114. I can connect to the IP address, and when the server actually responds, look up the TLSA record. The TLSA record, you take the server name, prepend __25.tcp, just like SRV records, and ask for TLSA, and it gives you this reply that says for __25_tcp melee.debian.org, the TLSA record is 311, which is the usage scenario, followed by the SHA-256 of the server public key. So all I have to do now is handshake TLS and verify that the SHA-256 of the TLS server key is the same as the one that I got from secure DNS. So that's basically the protocol. So what's going on here? We don't have hundreds of trusted certificate authorities, or maybe 1,000 trusted registration authorities. Instead, we have a secure copy of the public root server public keys. We have trust in the DNS zone of Debian.org or example.com here, plus its parents. So that's three levels of DNS. And then we just look up the TLSA record and compare the certificate info that we get from the TLSA record with the information that we get in the real server certificate. So in this case, there is no downgrade attack. So this solves two problems. One is it can eliminate the public PKI infrastructure problem, and it can eliminate the downgrade attack, because if the client looks up the TLSA record, it knows this server will talk TLS. If for some reason the server doesn't speak TLS, then I am not going to deliver mail. So there's no downgrade. If for some reason DNS is supported, somebody spoofs the example.com or Debian.org records, then they won't be properly signed. The way secure DNS works, I have the public keys of the root servers. They give me the public key for the servers one level down, and so on down. So DNS is okay, and TLS is okay. So August 2012, the RFC was published. First quarter 2013, Victor starts implementing Dane for Postfix. In parallel, he works with one of the developers for XSIM. And so for a while, they work in parallel. And then the XSIM developer gets a job. So that changes his priorities, and at this point, XM implementation is not finished. It is hoped that it will be finished soon, because it would be good if there is at least, well, if there are at least two implementations of a protocol before you can make some serious claims about how well it works. So Postfix 2.11 released 2 weeks ago has Dane in the stable release. You're definitely invited to try it out. First you have to set up your DNS, which from the client point of view is not so hard. If you want to publish your own zones in secure DNS, that's a very different matter. But just for client side, so that you can deliver your mail in the confidence that it will really be delivered to the server where you thought it was going, that's not such a big deal. You have to be prepared for the occasional DNS server that mishandles queries that it didn't expect. For example, companies like NIST, they alias their mail to outlook.com, and the outlook.com DNS servers don't respond well to TLSA queries. I guess it will be fixed eventually. But for those, you will have to make an exception in the Postfix configuration, says don't use Dane. There's a TLS README document, and I mentioned that this very long document. People are working on a Dane README document that will be much shorter and more focused, and hopefully easier to understand. Okay. LMDB, database support. That's the last section of my presentation. Speed it up, I can still make it in the deadline. So, unexpected consequences. In June 2013, Oracle releases BerkeleyDB version 6, and it has a different license. And people are becoming concerned. So what's the difference? The old BerkeleyDB license is BSD-ish, copyleft-ish, and it says if you create work, if you distribute work that uses BerkeleyDB, you must provide the source code to your work. And that's the old copyleft approach. And then everybody was okay with that. The BerkeleyDB 6 is under a different license. It's AGPL, the Afro Public License. And the Afro Public License says, besides the old copyleft clause, it says, you must also make your source code available if you provide a service. And this, of course, is targeted at all those, you know, big Facebook and so on services that never that provide a service but don't release their source code because they don't have to. But now they have to. If they use BerkeleyDB or anything that is AGPL licensed, even if you never distribute your code, you have to distribute it anyway. You have to make it available. And the bone of contention is that GPL2, which doesn't require the blue box, and GPL3, and GPL3, which does, they cannot be combined. You cannot legally combine those two different code that has these different licenses. If it says GPL2 or later, then it's good. But if it says GPL2, then there's a problem. You would have to relicense the GPL2 code to GPL3 or later. So that was the problem. A lot of people weren't ready to do that, to relicense all the GPL2 code. And so they started looking around, and they saw LMDB. And they thought, hey, it looks like BerkeleyDB if you look at it in a particular direction. It looks like BerkeleyDB. It has an open LDAP license, which is good. It is memory mapped. Size is limited by how many bits your addressing hardware can take. And that's like 48 bits on many 64-bit CPUs. You get 47 bits of addressing space. That's 128 terabytes. And I thought about it. 128 terabytes is not a lot. I have 2 terabytes here. 128 is like only, you know, a few years of internet cycle and we're there. Every laptop will have 120 terabytes. So, you can wait until the CPUs get broader, or you can just shard it over multiple files. It adds a little latency, but that's okay. So it has a lot of good buzzwords like copy on write, MVCC, zero copy, where it makes sense. It is multi-reader, very optimized for multi-reader, and it is single writer. The idea is that you don't change your databases as often as you read them, which is usually right. Ported by its author, Howard Chu, to a dozen open source projects, including PostFix. And I must say, the integration in PostFix took a while. It took 5 iterations. We did some heavy, heavy construction in PostFix and in LMDB to make it work. And I will kindly summarize. So what happens when you have two different systems and you join them together, if their environmental assumptions are similar enough, then it will be a fit. If the environmental assumptions are different, and in the case of PostFix and LMDB they were, it will be a bit of a struggle, but eventually it will fit. It just takes some effort. So LMDB, so PostFix, many people are using PostFix, and you are all professional system administrators, of course. But a lot of people who run PostFix are not professional system administrators. And so, whereas LMDB is for LDAP servers who are, typically you don't find LDAP servers on laptops. But they are run more professionally. They're more for a static environment. And PostFix is, the last thing is a static, well-maintained environment. It just has to deal with things. So LDB has a limit, configurable limit on the size of the database, and with PostFix, I have no idea what the limit is going to be. I just have to allow for sudden load spikes where, you know, it needs more space, and so the system shouldn't fail. So LMDB 098 allows PostFix to resize the database, and a lot of pain went away. Another environmental assumption was that LMDB is used by one user. So you have one server, LDAP, runs multiple database backends, but they're all running as the same user. And in the case of PostFix, this part runs as root, and this part runs as PostFix, and this part runs as someone else. They're all different UIDs, and that was done, of course, because of this titanic partitioning scheme. But it means that you have multiple user IDs trying to do access to the file. And with LMDB, in order to read the file, you must have write permission on the log file. And in the case of PostFix, that would mean writable log files, world writable log files under /etc/postfix, which was definitely not going to happen. And so we found a way out. And the way out was to say, OK, we're not using LMDB's locking. We're doing the old style external logs. And so I use the file handle on the database, but I do fcontrol read lock or exclusive lock, depending on what I want to do. So that eliminated the problem of the writable log files. Another thing that is also environmentally based, PostFix is using different users and they're all doing different things. An information leak where heap memory was written to the database in chunks of up to 4K. That's the page size. But I was very uncomfortable with the idea of writing arbitrary pieces of old memory that had been used for who knows what into the database. So I requested that this be changed, that LMDB erases memory before using it. And that's happening at 0.9.10. 0.9.11, which is where we are now, eliminates a problem where I made a mistake, I admit. And PostFix daemons just fell out of the sky without logging anything. So I first spent half a day trying to figure out what the heck was going on. It was a very sporadic error that started happening 4 weeks after deploying LMDB in PostFix. And so that was a bit of a puzzle. I found it after a day. I speculated and I was lucky. It turned out that LLDB uses assert, and assert writes to standard error and terminates. Not giving postfix an opportunity to write a log file message and say, oh, I have a problem here. So that is fixed. And at that point, I decided that it was good for the stable release LNDB. If there's a problem, even if it's my mistake, it will log an error message before going away, and that will simplify the support. So we have the first persistent database in Postgres that is safe for multiple writers. Thank you. It is not exactly BerkeleyDB drop-in replacement, as we have found out. And I expect that it will be safer than BerkeleyDB because of the copy-on-write implementation. There is less opportunity for screwing up. And last slide. Honestly. Honestly, I don't need it. Postfix lessons learned. What I have learned in the 15 years is invent sparingly. Like I said, why inflict another mail system on humanity? It will be there forever. It will make system administrators' life miserable because they have maintained just another system. So I try to invent sparingly. Use things that, if they work, don't be shy in adopting them. So I built the stable and infrastructure protocols into Postfix, but I try to not build everything into Postfix. There are other mail systems that try to build everything into the mail system, but I try to avoid that. So planning for change, make it pluggable. Timo said something about having a core mail system, having a core system and pluggable services. I have a similar approach. It makes a system, it actually means that you can keep running the same old mail system. You can update it by plugging in whatever is the latest anti-spam authentication plugin. Optimization, you cannot just optimize for the common case because you don't control what happens, you know? You don't control the internet. So if there is a worst case scenario, like using one connection per process, one process per connection, then at some point, this will just use up all your processes. So don't optimize for the common case, optimize the worst case and the common case. And also, with a little tongue-in-cheek to Timo, don't let the C prototype become your final implementation. I really did not want to do this in C. But, so I thought I will do a first implementation so I can scope out the problem. Well, that took just 10 years or so. The idea then was to implement a language on top of C, a configuration language that would be the user interface to the mail system. It hasn't happened. I hope it may happen at some point in time, but don't hold your breath. Okay, thank you.